also want to thank Tiffany House for inviting me to talk about this subject and to share the results with you today. And first, I would like to start by saying that patient-reported outcomes become more and more important, I think, in research. Not only for me as a clinician, but also for regulatory agencies and also for funding agencies. So, and I think that the Erasmus MC IPA survey is a real good example of what patient-reported outcomes can do and what they can mean. So I would like to go quickly through the time frame of this survey. And it was actually initiated in 2002, so a couple of years after the first clinical trials had been initiated in humans, but before the large trial in late onset patients, the LOTS trial, had started. And so also before start of before approval by the FDA of the treatment. So there are also really relevant natural course data in this survey. And yesterday it was already mentioned by Fabio Di Pietro during the dinner that it was a really successful survey with the help of the IPA, all the patients, and it has resulted in many papers published in peer-reviewed journals. And here on the left you can see Marloes Hagemans. She was the first one working on this survey. Next was Denis Gungor, and she was followed by Chris van der Meijden, and now we have Meng Wan working on the survey. Just a little bit of a history. How did it start? As I said, it started in 2002, and at that moment therapy for Pompe disease was being developed. First trials were being performed, but little was known about the disease actually in children and adults with the disease. And it was realized already then that it would be, in time, be more and more difficult to get natural data on the disease. And so that the majority of patients would eventually start the treatment, and there would be no data to compare this treatment to. And so all patients were scattered around the world at different treatment centers. So we really needed an efficient tool to gather information that we needed. So with help of the patients, experts, and the available literature at that time, this survey was created, and it really covers most aspects of life and the most frequent problems that patients encounter. And it was also addresses the clinical course and the severity of the disease, but also the impact of the disease on the life of the patients. And as a side effect, we can also use it to monitor and evaluate the treatment effects. So at first, this all started together with the IPA and the representatives of the IPA in a couple of countries. And the survey, which was at that time a paper questionnaire survey, now it's an email survey, were distributed through the patient organizations affiliated with the IPA. And since then, we have a yearly follow-up of the patients to send it around. And we have now in this survey more than 500 unique patients with Pompe disease, and here you can see where they are from. Many patients, of course, are from the Netherlands, but also quite an amount of patients from the USA, so probably many of you already participate also in this survey. There are a lot of patients from Germany, but also from France, Australia, Canada, so we have many patients across the world. And it has already shown us some couple of details about that 43% uses already respiratory support at inclusion of the survey. More than 300 patients now receive ERT, and we have a median follow-up of more than 6.5 years of these patients. And of course, new patients are coming in every year, so this has resulted in now for as the survey consists of 4 separate questionnaires for so long, we have now more than 20,000 questionnaire data. So that's really an enormous amount of data that we have. And I will show you some of the results of this survey. And this, you can see what kind of symptoms that the patients have and the disease progression that the patients have. And what can be appreciated from this data, and it has been said before, also in Taiwan, the delay to the diagnosis for the late onset patients was about 6 years. And also in the survey, we saw that it took 7 years from patients presenting with their first symptoms to the diagnosis. So there's really some work to do for us. But not only were we informed about the symptoms, but we can also look at how these symptoms impact the participation in daily life. And this is addressed by a generic questionnaire, the Rotterdam Handicap Scale, which addresses 9 domains, for example, mobility indoors and outdoors, but also work and study. And what is shown is that patients with Pompe disease, compared to the general population, score lower on this scale. And lower scores on this scale mean a more severe handicap. And we were able to follow what happened during the natural course before the patients were treated, and we saw a gradual decline in scores, meaning an increase in disease severity, so an increase in level of handicap. And after the start of year 3, we saw a stabilization, so this means good news for the patients. But what was also striking was that fatigue is actually one of the most disabling symptoms in the majority of patients. And normally you say that a patient is fatigued when he has a score on the FSS, the fatigue severity scale, of above 4. And you can see that patients already, if they are fully ambulatory, they are still being very severely fatigued. And when you compare this to healthy controls, they should score under 3. So there's a real difference between them. And also when you apply treatment, you can see a little decrease in the level of fatigue, but it does not return to normal levels in healthy people. And I think one of the most important aspects is how does the disease impact the quality of the life of the patients. And what you can see here is that it is reduced compared to the general population, and it is reduced the most in the physical domain, which would be expected, but you can also see a diminished scores in the health and the mental health domains. So this has an important impact on the life of the patients. And when you start treatment, you see an improvement in the physical aspects, but not in the mental aspects of this treatment. But what's good to say that is you can see a stabilization. And we know for survival from the infants, they usually don't survive beyond 1 year of age when you do not treat them. But survival is something very difficult to address in the adult patients. And for this you need the numbers of patients, and this was also a topic that could be addressed by this survey. And what was found is that untreated patients have a higher mortality than the general population. And actually, on average, the survival after the diagnosis is 27 years in the non-treated patients. But what's also positive is that when you treat patients with ERT, they have a diminished chance of dying to the disease. But we still see patients that die because of respiratory complications or other complications. So there's still very much room for improvement. And it was also shown, it was also addressed by one of the other speakers, that although enzyme replacement therapy has a positive effect on survival, it was also shown that it has a positive effect on the risk of being wheelchair dependent, but it had no impact on the risk for becoming ventilator dependent. And I think this survey was also used to address many other topics. The potential benefit of the newborn screening, which we had a good discussion on before, but also the financial and economic burden. And it was also used as a starting point for the development of new questionnaires, such as the IPACT. And it has already been mentioned by Benedict. And I think in some ways it's quite a unique questionnaire because it was created by you. And it was created by asking patients, what are your most limiting problems? And therefore, this IPA survey was used in more than 250 patients. From that, we constructed a preliminary questionnaire of 50 items. And after testing and reducing the number of items, we now have a final scale of 18 items, which is really easily to fill in because you just have three response options. No, I cannot. Yes, but with some difficulty. And yes, without any difficulty. But what does it really measure? This RPEG scale measures your ability in daily life, so your activity in daily life. And what's unique is that it's specific to patients with Pompe disease, since it was developed using all your information. And there's another unique aspect of this questionnaire, which I try to explain to you, because normally you all fill in questionnaires and you have numbers from 0, 1, 3, and you have a couple of questions, and you add all numbers up. And then when you start a treatment, you assume that a shift from improvement from 0 to 2 is the same as an improvement from 1 to 3. But actually, that's very unlikely. So you would need a scale that measures more in a linear, in a continuous way, so that a shift from 0 to 10 is the same as a shift from 30 to 40, as we measure with the temperature. So I think that's a really important asset of this measure. And so we use a kind of a difficult mathematical RASH model to make this transformation. But now what you're able to do is transform a simple questionnaire into a linear ruler, into a linear scale. So when you now, for example, I have these patients, this is one who can eat with difficulty but is unable to run, he will probably be at a lower end of the spectrum, while this patient, who can do both items very easily, is at the upper end of the spectrum. So this patient is in a better clinical condition than the other patient. And because you are now on a linear ruler, you can easily compare the patients with each other. And you can also compare the effect of the treatment. And what we have shown is that this patient-reported outcome reflects really quite nicely the effects that we measure with other outcome measures, such as strength measurements and functional measurements. And initially, this new questionnaire was developed with answering from 168 patients from the Netherlands, Belgium, UK, USA, and Canada, but we now are in the middle of the process of making it available to more of you. So we have made translations, and together with our European colleagues, which are united in the European Pompe Consortium, we have now recruited more than 250 new patients who have filled in this questionnaire from Germany, France, Switzerland, Italy, and also new patients from the Netherlands. And since this year, it has also been incorporated in the IPA survey. So we'll probably get more new patients that is really needed to validate this scale to make it available to all of you. And does it work? This is maybe a difficult graph to understand for you, but what I would like to show you is that you can really see a nice distribution of patients across the scale. So you can measure patients at every end of the spectrum, whether they are very severely affected or they are only having mild symptoms. So I think that's one of the great benefits, potential benefits of this scale. And I think there are many future opportunities for this scale. It's now being used in many of the new clinical trials with the next generation drugs, so we will be able to compare also what the new treatments do on the activity level of the patients, and there may be many more opportunities. So that was the past and the present, but how about the future? And I cannot say it as beautiful as it was done by Ryan Colburn, but I think you are the key for collaboration. You know your disease, so you are the core, and now you are surrounded by gathered in patient organizations, and we as clinicians are also getting more contact with each other. We are collaborating in different networks across the world, and by using these collaborations we will be able to address new questions, and we will be able to see which patients would do best on the new treatments that are upcoming, and we would be have a platform to see easily which patients would fulfill criteria for new and upcoming trials. And we would also be able to address any new questions coming up from the Pompe community. So we would be able to unravel the mechanisms underlying the differences we see in the response to the treatment, and also compare the treatments to each other. And we will probably be able to define new phenotypes, test new systems in which you can really perform therapeutic studies, and also develop new outcome measures. And I think only through this collaboration we will be able to, in the end, create a real worldwide network. And I think that's what we need. So with this, I really would like to thank all the patients that have participated in this survey for so many years, and of course also all IPA representatives and the persons from my team that have collaborated on this. So thank you very much.